Hi everyone, welcome to Show It Better. I try to make this list as different as possible so everyone can leave with at least one valuable tip. Some of these tips are very personal and things that I always use when drawing. So this applies to hand drawings as well. So let's get started. Darken your whites and lighten your blacks. Sometimes true black and true white can be very overwhelming colors to our eyes. The easiest thing we can do nowadays is go to Photoshop and select black and fill our walls or select white for a solid background. But having these strong colors can be sometimes too strong on the viewer, and we can lose sight of other details in our drawings. I love, for example, when light and darkness is saved for special occasions. We value it so much more. You can see this in many buildings. Sometimes when you're in a hospital or a mall, there's just light everywhere. Everything is filled with light, and sometimes our eyes finish wasted with this. Instead, there are some buildings that create moments of light and moments of darkness. When you're in a Gothic church, for example, everything is very dim until a beam of sunlight enters, and we value light. This also applies to your drawings. Make white or black a precious prize. Only use them for special things. Don't give them away that easy, right? So if you're creating a drawing, select your black color and lighten it up just a little bit. Or select your white background and make it a little bit off-white. There are many examples in advertising that show this in a great way. Reference classic drawings. So many students need to hear this nowadays. I know that we're in a digital era, and when you're creating a drawing, you instantly turn to your favorite architects or Instagram pages to get references. This is cool, but over time it can get very unoriginal and your drawings will just be one of a bunch, you know? They will all be the same, they will all feel the same, and yeah, that's not cool. There are so many valuable references in classical drawings that it's so crazy how underrated all of them are. When I say classical drawings, I don't necessarily mean, you know, 15th to 18th century drawings. I mean drawings that have stood in time. For example, Boulez's dramatic drawings, Choisy's axonometric details, Mies van der Rohe's collages, Michael Gandy's paintings, Frederick Schinkel's sceneries, and Aldo Rossi's drawings and paintings. There are tons of references to look at and practically apply to your own projects. What if your next section, you know, was like Newton's cenotaph section? A cloudy dramatic sky, dark to light shadows, a textured background? Or instead of a typical axonometric view, you try a Choisy style axonometric view, where the view is from below, right, and it's a little bit sectioned. Or forget about your renders, leave only the essential, just like Mies did. Surprise your teachers and colleagues with different ways of showing your projects. If the idea is clear, then it's a good drawing. Underinform or overinform. Always have clear what information you need to get through to your clients or teachers. Don't just make pretty drawings. You know, if it lacks basic information like indicating the north, the scale of the drawing, where a section is made, or basic dimensions, then your drawing is pretty much useless. And on the other hand, if you fill your drawings with technical information like materials, details, structure calculations, and every type of dimension you find on AutoCAD, then it'll be saturated and very hard to read. A project has many phases. You want to do a drawing that goes with each of them, right? So if you're in a schematic phase, then you don't want to be too detailed. But if you're in a construction phase, you have to be as detailed as possible. When you think you are done with a drawing, take the point of view of another person and make basic questions, you know, like, what view is this? Is this a top view, section, facade? Do I need to indicate what view it is, or is it clear? Where's the sun coming from? Should I insert north? What is the scale of this? Should I insert a human scale? Are all these dimensions really necessary? Etc, etc, etc. Next, know the size of your text. This is such a common issue everywhere. I mean, it doesn't matter if it's printed or digital drawings. Many people don't realize how their drawings are going to be seen or read, you know, and what dimension they're going to be seen. So they don't put too much attention in the text size. it's very often that I'm reviewing university projects, and from my point of view, I can't read a single text because of how small a text is. Or in the opposite way, some people fill their presentation boards with only text and leave no white space or no space for the drawings at all. What I recommend is first knowing where your drawing is going to be seen. If you're presenting a competition and you know the judges are going to have a printed presentation board on the wall, then in your house, stand about a meter away from your wall and try to read some text, right, in different sizes. Once you find the size that is right, that is, you know, legible, and you know that you can read it from afar, apply that to your presentation boards. Second, don't get creative with typography for your architecture drawings. You just need a legible lettering, that's it. An Helvetica will do. Don't overdo it. You know, some people just start downloading so many creative textures that in the end it's difficult to read, right? So a simple typography is fine, right? Make it legible. Next, align your drawing symbols. You want your drawing to look as clean and understandable as possible. This may seem like you're a perfectionist, but if a drawing symbol is not aligned with the rest, people are going to tell the difference. If your dimension lines are a little bit distant from each other, then we are going to notice. Even if it takes a little bit more time, align everything in your drawings. You will see the difference in the end. And finally, your colors. I have said this before and I'll say it again. Have a color palette and stick to it, right? This applies to renderings, but it also applies to plans, sections, any type of drawing. There should be a dominant color or a set of colors that go with each other. Sometimes, you know, more than, you know, two or three is more than enough. If you don't know what colors to use, try a color palette generator. Insert your reference drawing or your movie still or painting, and it will generate a color palette for you. Then when you're doing your drawing, import the color palette and apply the colors accordingly. Also, make sure the colors between the sections, facades, and plans match, right? That way they look part of a whole. So I hope these tips were useful for now. I'll try to include more in the future. What do you think? Which one of these do you already apply in your projects? Type it in the comments. See you in the next video. Bye.